morning. Good to see you here this morning. Glad to see you feeling better.
Yes, Lord, thank you for praying.
God is good to us.
Yes.
God is so good.
So good. There we go. Got this, got that.
Yeah, I think it was 2 years ago. Halloween was on Sunday.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
I did it.
I decided to do a Halloween sermon. That was just.
You know, and I don't know, thought about that.
I'm revisiting that story.
Oh,
that
good.
I was saying, I think it was 2 years ago.
I'm going to call you, but I'm going to remind you of
who's that?
You get that ready because he's, they're here.
I agree.
Very cold lunch, not diesel.
If I found it, I dropped that ass. It disappeared, I didn't know where it was.
He just picked it up somewhere, I didn't know where it was. He went that little off there. Down.
Very cold. He called my friend and said,
Sunday morning. Good to see all those bright and shining faces here. Welcome, welcome to a Sunday morning, and welcome to everyone watching online. We're going to be in the Blue Book this morning, starting with number one in the Blue Book, Worship the King. Thank you for all you do in our life. Thank you for all the answered prayers. Pray that just continue to guide us and help us to be a light for you in the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go ahead and turn over to number 40. Hymn number 40 in the book. God, great is thy faithfulness.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everybody doing?
We're here.
Good to be here.
I didn't know if anybody was going to show up today. Y'all came in late. All right, we're in Luke chapter 10. Luke 10 and verse 17. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for all the things that you teach us, and we pray that your spirit would be here to guide us and help us to understand what we're learning and convict us and guide us, direct our lives. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Luke 10, verse 17. The 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. He replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. And we'll stop there. It's fascinating that the Lord Jesus, as he sends the 72 out to do something that they're overwhelmed by, Luke tells us they scattered throughout the area, you know, they carried out this ministry that God had given them. And now they're returning, and you can just feel their excitement, you know. Especially as you read verse 17, just sensing what they must have been going through in their minds. They were excited that they'd been given this power to do all of these miracles and cast out demons. And it says they returned with joy. Now, I'm sure, you know, part of that joy was the sense of their success that they had experienced. They had known rejection. They had seen Jesus being harassed at various times, you know, and they had seen Jesus be opposed, especially by the religious leaders and whatnot. And they had been through Galilee, and they'd seen all kinds of things that had taken place, and now all of a sudden, you know, they have this opportunity to experience this harvest of believers, and they're experiencing this ripe fruit that was ready for them. And they sensed that God had sent them out at the right time, and they were just excited, you know, to be a part of that. Now, before Jesus had sent them out, he said, we talked about this last week, remember, he said, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And, you know, one of the things about harvesting is it's useless to harvest green fruit before it's ripe. It's useless to try to get, you know, something productive before it's ready. And sometimes, you know, that can be true too with harvesting Christians or bringing people to the Lord at the wrong time, trying to force it. You know, sometimes Christians try to force somebody to make a decision before, you know, they're ready to do it. And the Lord doesn't call us to do that. You know, he's the Lord of the harvest, and he's put a calling on our lives. And part of the reason the Spirit lives in us, I think, is to have discernment on some of those areas. You know, is this person ready to receive the Lord, or do they need some more time? You know, do they need to think about it some more and study the Bible a little more, and just, you know, being sensitive to the Spirit in that area is so important, I think, because if you try to force it at the wrong time, sometimes it can have a negative effect. But just trying to know if someone is ready, you know, to be committed. But the Lord hasn't just called us to the harvesting part. He's also called us just to throw some seeds out there, you know. Paul had talked about that, you know, some of us put the seeds down, some of us water the seeds, and then, you know, the Lord actually is the one that brings in the harvest. But you know, you might just be a seed planter. A lot of the things you do, and someone else that comes along will water that seed, and you know, it might be a few years before that person comes to the Lord. So you're also called to just sow, and you're called to water. Maybe you know someone that had a seed planted a few years ago, maybe they need a little more push, you know, it's been a while. And so again, there's just all of these different stages of someone coming to the Lord and kind of just being insensitive. I mean, to be sensitive about, you know, where they're at and if they're ready to make a decision. So just knowing whom the Lord has prepared, the people that are ripe for harvest, just like you recognize ripe fruit, right? You can tell if it's ready to be most of the time. Anyway, I cut into an avocado the other day. It was almost it turned black, and I thought it was going to be brown inside, and I couldn't even cut into it. It wasn't even ripe yet. So sometimes fruit can deceive you, but a lot of times you can tell if it's ready, you know, and it's ripe. So we need to be sensitive for those things, and there is joy in that, when you, especially if you get to take part in the harvesting part, and you help bring someone to the Lord, you know, and there's a real joy and excitement that we can receive from that. So these 72 that Jesus sent out on this mission trip, you know, they come back, they're joyful for what God has done, but they're also joyful because, you know, they experience the power of God working through them. And they said to Jesus, "Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name." So they're excited, you know, because they had done what Jesus had done. You know, they're witnessing. They have witnessed for a long time and just seen Jesus do all these things, you know, to cast out demons and do all these miracles and everything. And now they're being a part of that. Now they're being able to set people free from demonic powers and whatnot. And just to experience that, and that now they're, you know, set free from these spiritual demonic spirits and everything, and such a dramatic change that can be. So they were thrilled about this, and Jesus' response to them was that he too saw this from a spiritual perspective. In verse 18, he says, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." Now, it's interesting, the Bible speaks in a lot of different ways about Satan falling from heaven. For example, in Isaiah chapter 14, it talks about the past, when Satan rebelled against God, and he uses the picture of him having fallen from heaven and being thrown down to the earth. Isaiah 14:12 says, "How you've fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. You've been thrown down to the earth, you who destroyed the nations of the world, for you said in your heart, 'I will ascend to heaven and set my throne above God's stars. I will sit enthroned on the mount of assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain, I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High.' But instead, you will be brought down to Sheol, the place of the dead, down to its lowest depths." And then there's also a passage in Ezekiel 28:12 where God says, "You were the perfection of wisdom and beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Your clothing was adorned with every precious stone, red carnelian, chrysolite, white moonstone, beryl, onyx, jasper, sapphire, turquoise, and emerald, all beautifully crafted for you and set in the finest gold. They were given to you on the day that you were created. I anointed you and ordained you as the mighty angelic guardian cherub. You had access to the holy mountains of God, and you walked among the stones of fire. You were blameless in all that you did from the day you were created until evil was found in you. Your great wealth filled you with violence, and you sinned, so I banished you from the mountain of God. I expelled you, Almighty Guardian, from your place among the stones of fire, because your heart was filled with pride because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor, so I threw you down to the earth. So those were kind of some two passages of scripture talking about Satan being thrown down to the earth, you know, in the beginning part. But then also, Jesus talks about, like, during Jesus' lifetime on earth, he talks about Satan being overcome and being overpowered and people being set free, partly because the Son of Man was in the world and he was, you know, binding the devil, and he was casting out all these demonic spirits. And then, remember that one that had 6,000 demons in? So Jesus was doing that. And here in Luke 10:18, he describes the mission work of the 72 disciples as Satan falling from heaven, because God's word is being accomplished. You know, the light of Christ is being spoken into these dark places, and people are coming to the Lord. And so, you know, it's like Satan falling from heaven. And as the cross, you know, grows closer, Jesus says in John chapter 12, verse 31, "Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world," meaning Satan, "will be driven out." So he's driven out, but he's also not driven out. You know what I mean? Because the cross did bind the devil in certain ways, and he was driven out if you're a Christian and you have this Holy Spirit in your heart. But he's still in the world, right? He's still causing evil, and bad things are still happening. Now, at the resurrection, Paul will write to the Romans saying, "Satan will soon be crushed underneath your feet." Now, that doesn't mean permanently and forever, though, but it's talking about your spiritual warfare. He's talking to these Romans. We haven't got to that section yet. It's in chapter 16 in Romans. But he's talking about, you know, that as you grow in Christ and the Holy Spirit's working through you, that the power of Satan is being crushed underneath your feet. You're destroying his work, you know, because you're doing the work of God. So it's not in a literal sense. It's, a lot of times it's hard in the Bible to know whether to take something literally or figuratively, right? And Jesus often spoke in figurative language, but sometimes he spoke in, you know, literal language too. And that's where it gets kind of tough to know. But that one, especially in Romans, "Satan will soon be crushed underneath your feet," I think it's more symbolic of just the power of Satan being crushed underneath your feet when you're doing the work of God and you're carrying out the gospel mission, right? Because we're overcoming the satanic forces that are against us as the church, as the body of Christ. In Revelation 20:10, you know, you have the literal sense of it. The final casting out and defeat of Satan says, "And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet had been thrown, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever." So that's the final casting out and destruction of the enemy. But all throughout, you know, you have these moments where the devil is being bound or cast out in a kind of a symbolic sense. Yes, Pam?
This talks about the 72 having this. For some reason, I always thought that it was only the disciples that could do all these things, like trample on snakes and scorpions and overcome.
Yeah, no, he's talking to the 72.
And so, and then in Mark 16, it talks about the same thing.
Well, yeah. Okay, so, but I don't think he's talking about literally stepping on snakes and scorpions. I think in the context, you know, he's talking about the spiritual warfare going on, and the devil is always referred to as a snake, and I think he's talking about that they're crushing snakes and scorpions. What he's really saying is, you know, they're crushing the evil powers of the enemy.
So they were able to, cast out demons the rest of their lives?
Well, I don't know about the rest of their lives, but Jesus, for that mission trip, he gave them the power to do that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I can.
I mean, there's nothing that says either way, but I would assume just for this mission trip that he gave him specific power to do it for that mission trip. Just like the 12, I mean, the 12 also did miracles in the book of Acts, but I think for that mission trip, that first mission trip they went on, he gave them a special authority and power for that time and place. Then after he died and rose again and the Spirit fell on them, then they were given powers in the book of Acts to do other things, but I think that happened after the Spirit came on them. So I think that for these two different mission trips, it was kind of a specific thing. That, but I could be wrong, but it seems that that's what it was. Yeah.
Do we know how long those 72 were gone on that mission?
No, that's another thing we're in the dark about. But we know that Jesus, taught and preached for only a little over 3 years. So I'm guessing maybe a couple months, maybe. I don't know, but probably not a long, long time. So all of these things, all of these different times in the scripture, and there's other ones too, but they're spoken of as, you know, the enemy being cast out or kind of bound in some way. But it's not the final defeat until the end, you know. So another place that Satan was defeated was at the cross, of course, right? That's where Satan was ultimately, he was defeated. The ultimate place he was defeated was there, but he's still alive and kicking, as we all know. But the reason why he's defeated is that if we are in Christ, Christ is our Lord and Master, and he's placed his Spirit in us, then we can have power over the enemy, because he can't possess us like all those people that were possessed that they were casting out. The enemy cannot possess our souls, because the Spirit of God is living in there. And so we don't have to worry about that. Now we can be tempted. The devil can whisper in your ear to do all kinds of things, and you can still submit to that temptation. But you can't be possessed and controlled by Satan anymore if you are a child of God. So in that way, he's defeated. And also that you are a child of God, that you belong to the King now, and you're going to go to heaven. You're not going to go to hell. And that's what Satan's goal is, to get everybody to go to hell. So, you know, everybody that accepts the Lord, you know, he's being defeated in that way too. But also there's scripture that talks about the Satan controlling the hell. In Hebrews it says that in chapter 2 that Satan held the keys to the power of death. Until Jesus died on the cross, you know, that he took those keys away from him. And now Jesus has defeated death. And death was our great enemy, right? We were going to die, all of us, and go to hell until Jesus died on the cross. And now death is just a portal into eternity now. But it wasn't going to be if Jesus didn't come and save us. So all of that's changed. So in a lot of ways, you know, hell was defeated at the cross. The devil was defeated at the cross. Death was defeated at the cross. Our sins were defeated at the cross. So many things were defeated at the cross. So ultimately, Satan and the power he possessed and the havoc that he can do was, if you're in Christ, it's done and defeated. But of course, there's a lot of people that don't accept the Lord, and those people are still bound by sin and controlled by vanity. So, but the Lord Jesus, he's saying something very profound here. He's reminding us that there's an enemy in the harvest field, right? He's trying to stop the harvest being, the harvest being harvested, right? He's a real enemy. And the harvest is plentiful, but one of the things he does is he gives us to not go out and work in the harvest field. Because Jesus says the workers are few. I know there's a lot of Christians in the world, but how many of them are really out in the fields doing the harvesting? So because the workers are few, you know, the work isn't getting done, so the enemy is winning in that way. So he's still there. He's still, remember with that parable about the seeds, and it was thrown on different parts of the soil, and it said the first seed was thrown on the hard, paved soil, and the birds came down to swoop the seed up before it could get into the ground, and Jesus said that the birds were the devil. The devil comes and takes the word away before it has a chance to, you know, penetrate into the soil. So he's still doing a lot of, you know, of work. People that come to church that don't know the Lord, but they're seekers. A lot of those, you know, they'll maybe hear a sermon or several sermons, but it never sinks in because they let the devil snatch the word of God away before it takes root. I can't talk about all this to not bring in what Paul said. I know we all know it pretty well, but Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you might be able to stand your ground. And after having done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. And in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's saints. So, there's a lot of work to be done, and we need to, you know, prevent the enemy from working on our own hearts and penetrating our own hearts and minds, because like I said, we can still give into temptation. So the fight is still on until the Lord comes back, or we die first and go to heaven, but there's still a battle. And part of preaching, you know, out on the mission field, proclaiming the name of Jesus, that's how Satan is being defeated, because people are being set free. So the more we do that, you know, the more that we are accomplishing that goal and defeating, working with Christ to defeat the enemy. But he reaffirms their authority. Notice in verse 19 he says, he addresses the 72 when he says, I've given you authority, you know, like Pam was saying, to trample snakes and scorpions to come. But see how the next phrase is to overcome all the power of the enemy, and that they will not harm you. So I think he's talking symbolically of the powers of the enemy. So the snakes and scorpions, he's using that symbolic language. That they were given power over anything that Satan could do on this mission trip, at least on this mission trip. Maybe it was longer, but at least for this mission trip, they were given that authority. Now, as believers, like I said, you know, we have protection from Satan. 1 John 5:18 says, we know that those who have been part of God's family do not make it a practice of sinning, and God's Son keeps them safe, and the evil one cannot harm them. And 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So if you have the Spirit in you, you don't need to fear the devil, because God's in you and his power is greater. So it's one of the truths of the gospel, you know, that believers, we don't have to run scared of Satan, because he is, you know, God's in control of our lives. But we do need to take the power of the evil one seriously, because it is a real power. But at the same time, if we're overcome by Satan, and if we're focused too much on the enemy and worried or living in fear of it, then that's wrong too, because God wants us to focus on him and his power and not be so concerned about the power of the demons. But we have the power of the Holy Spirit, which is a greater power. So if we focus too much on the enemy, we're missing the point, you know, that God's power is greater and we have it. And so we don't need to be in fear of that. God has promised us in the gospel, if we walk in fellowship with Christ, then, you know, we're guarded by the Spirit and we live under his protection. So, and then I'll just close with, we won't get it through all of it today, but with what Jesus says here in verse 20, he says he wants them to focus not so much on the spiritual victory that they're having over Satan, but the fact that their names are written in heaven. So he says, don't rejoice that the spirits submit to you, you know, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven, right? So, I mean, it's a great thing that God's working through you, but it's more about not what you're accomplishing for the Lord, but the fact that you have eternal life in Christ. So it's more about, he's saying it's more about the grace that God's given you than about the works that you're doing for him. That's kind of the main point there. Because you're doing these things in the name of Christ, and it's a great thing, but what's greater is God's grace that saved us and put our names written in heaven, and that's a greater thing to be excited and rejoice about. Amen?
Amen.
All right, so we'll stop there. I have more to talk about on this subject, but our time's kind of got to us, so let's pray. Father, we thank you for all that you say in your word and all the truths that are in there, and we thank you for the power of your Spirit that is greater than the enemy, and we don't need to fear him because we have your Holy Spirit to live in us, to guide us, to correct us when we need correcting, to comfort and strengthen us when we need comforting, when we need your power and your strength, and we know that we live according to your word and by the power of your Spirit. And so help us, Lord, to be a part of your work and be more involved in harvesting. There's so much harvest, and we need to be part of the workers that are out there harvesting. And so help us to be committed and to do what you've asked us to do, and to speak when we need to speak. And so give us the boldness and the strength to do that, and help us to have confidence in you, that you are great in us, and that we have great power because you live inside of us. We pray this.